I think the market should look on the bright side here, that the deadline is flexible. As long as they're talking and they're not escalating, then you don't have those tariffs that everyone back in the fourth quarter, you know, one of the reasons why you had the sell-off in the fourth quarter, there are a bunch of different reasons, but one reason was that there was this prospect of deep and broad tariffs being applied by the United States at the end of the year, and then China retaliating. And a lot of companies were saying that that would be serious bad news for the economy. As long as that keeps on getting pushed back, you know, it's going to take a long time to resolve all the different trade issues between the United States and China. As long as it's not escalating, that's good
news.
So
you'd be a buyer of the, would you be a buyer of Goodyear tire, which is an interesting, you know, example against the backdrop of what many people are worried about in the markets. Tariff, okay, maybe it is coming, maybe it's not, but it doesn't look great. And then slowing global growth.
Well, see, the other story, though, is the slowdown in China. And there are some people, including the president, who say, well, the reason why China's slowing is because of the trade war, because of trade sanctions from the United States. I disagree. I think China would be slowing now with or without a trade war. And what that means is that because there are deep entrenched issues going on. And what that means is that even if they struck a deal tomorrow, China's problems aren't going away. And so I don't think that that if a trade deal was reached tomorrow, I don't think that markets should react by saying, okay, everything's fine.
It's all clear. Peter, at the same time, many have made the point now that it's very rare that the U.S. gets pushed into any kind of real downturn by the rest of the world. We lead the way, for better or worse. They rely on us. It's not the other way around. Do you agree with that? Can we continue to grow maybe just at a little bit slower pace, even with China as weak as it is?
I think it's questionable. About 15% of the economy in the U.S. is related to trade. So you can argue that it's the U.S. consumer that's keeping us somewhat immune to what's going on overseas. And I have to question how long that can last, because I really believe that the direction of the stock market actually can affect consumer behavior here. And if you look at the S&P 500, 40% of revenue is sourced overseas. Mm-hmm. So we are going to get infected. It's just a question of to what degree. And can the stock market, after this rally that I believe was Fed-induced, is that sustainable when global growth is clearly slowing earnings growth is decelerating?
Right, as Bob has been pointing out. So do you think then we've kind of, you know, the Fed says, okay, we're going to change our tune, Peter. We're not, you know, we may not raise interest rates like we said this year. You think that only buys us a couple weeks of a rallying, you know, stock market off of a terrible fourth quarter?
Well, look at the last two times the Fed ended a tightening cycle. It was right before or in the midst of a recession. So you don't want the Fed, in a way, to be done with this rate hike cycle and then the next move to be a cut.
But they've paused before in this expansion. They sort of paused in 2016. Is this just another one of those episodes? This time is a little weird because interest rates are so low while this growth and this expansion continues.
You hope for a soft landing, but the odds of that are pretty low. Since World War II, it's only about 20% that they've accomplished that. And you can't ignore what's going on with yields around the world. That the Japanese 10-year is back below zero again, that German yields out to now 9 years are below zero, and the 10-year is at 10 basis points. You can't ignore that. And the U.S. 10-year is down 60 basis points just within the last couple of months.
But Patrick, here's the odd thing, and I wonder how you'd invest around it. That being the case, if we do something like a 2% growth, even for the year, you have interest rates as low as they are. Doesn't that argue for stocks? Where would you be invested?
Right. I mean, the equity risk premium right now, you know, the valuation of stocks is relative to where else you put them, right? And the equity risk premium now is well above average. It's around 5.6%. Historically, that has actually argued for above average returns over 5 years. It doesn't tell you what the stock market's going to do in the next year. You could have a recession. You could have a serious downturn.
But you're saying because
over time,
of that risk, the potential rewards are greater.
Right, because everyone is so scared of the next recession that they're pricing that into stocks relative to the returns that they could get in low interest rates. And at some point, maybe after the next cycle, after the cycle is ended and after we go through recession, that unwinds, actually get above average returns. So unless you think that you can perfectly time the market, which I'm skeptical of being able to do,
absolutely,
you look more at that 4 or 5 year time horizon in terms of where stocks are priced.
And the bulk of our family funds are in gold, cash,
value stocks.
Cheap
is good right now, because the market has shown that when you're an expensive stock, there's no room for error.
Yeah.
and it's getting more difficult to execute in a slowing environment. Therefore, high PE multiples are very difficult to sustain right now.
And value stocks have been out of fashion recently, so I think there's a lot of room for them to come into fashion.